We're based in Dallas-Fort Worth. As Dr. Libertor said, we have about 10,000 associates. About half of them are mathematics, science, engineering, operations research, technical folks, right? And then the other half are a variety of business expertise, many of them who are very passionate about their individual spaces that they play in. So whether it's hospitality or airline or cruise, whatever it is, they become expert in those spaces. Our technology is used by over a billion people a year to touch our technology in one way or the other, to plan their trips, to get the right price, to get where they need to go, but also to make sure an airline has a qualified crew, or make sure it has the right fuel load on the plane, or to make sure a hotel understands where they could best optimize their revenue as far as where they decide to distribute their product and how to price it. So the technology footprint is broad, and we do a tremendous amount of transactions. We talk a little bit about transaction processing around our building because we're running at 85,000 transactions a second. Okay, that's kind of up there in the high speed, high reliability computing at a transaction volume that's really only rivaled by a few folks out there, Google, Facebook, Twitter. Those types of companies now have kind of taken the lead in transaction processing, but in kind of what I like to call authentic tech, hardcore, data-driven, fat transactions, not simple ones. We're pushing 85,000 transactions a second through our computing enterprise. So high-scale computing, but that's really just the plumbing for all the cool stuff we're going to do. So I'm not going to talk about much plumbing today. One of my examples is a little bit more of the underside, but most of the stuff that I'm going to talk about is how we're bringing data and analytics to customers, right? So the original Sabre system was in the madman days, 1953, and there were two Mr. Smiths on an airplane, C.R. Smith, who ran American Airlines at the time, and R. Blair Smith, who was an IBM executive, and they started talking on a long flight between L.A. and New York, and Blair Smith brought up this idea that, you know, the Defense Department was using some unique technology at the time, and a lot of technology in those years came out of government, out of defense, but they were using some scale technology in the Defense Department that he thought could be used for automating the process of manual reservations, which is how airlines were taking reservations at the time. 6 years later, the original Sabre system was launched. Since then, the footprint of technology is very different, but we're still very big in the airline reservations business. We do airline reservation systems for about 75 airlines around the world. With the dawn of the internet, now most of you, yeah, I say that, and that's one of those things that tells you I graduated 30 years ago, because most of you, except for the alumni and some of the faculty and me, we saw the dawn of the internet. You've lived with it your whole lives, but that's about when I got into the travel technology side of the business, and it was an exciting time to be in that business. One of my early jobs, I had two areas. One was working on what was a very revolutionary new travel desktop for travel agencies, and it won a whole bunch of design awards and was a miserable failure. Nobody used it. Probably the biggest failed product launch that Sabre's ever had, so don't worry about failing. Hang in there. You could still get, if you hang around long enough, they'll make you the CEO. So people forget, right? I've disowned that project. But the other area I had was building the first generation websites for travel agencies as they were trying to move their business from traditional offline business to online. So I got to be involved with a lot of the early players in online travel. We used the term in our group to internet enable everything. So that's, you know, the internet was kind of this sideshow early on. And we started talking about internet enable everything, and travel quickly became the biggest category on the web. It's still a top three category today, but it went from really books and CDs at the time being sold online and other small ticket items to several hundred dollar airline tickets, and again, travel became the biggest category and remains a huge category online today. And at the same time, the airline side of our business was becoming known as a best-in-class place for operations research talent and for decision support systems. And the reason was that everything we did increasingly was driven around big sets of data that sat inside airlines and trying to help them figure out how to make good decisions based on those data. And there weren't a lot of companies doing that. And frankly, you know, today an operations research advanced degree person can work in any industry they want. At the time, the airline industry was a real magnet for those types of folks. So if you went up to MIT or if you went to Georgia Tech, the operations research talent was really interested in working in our industry. Today, they're just as likely to go to Goldman Sachs or to any big manufacturer because that skill set is valued pretty much in every industry. And that science of revenue management changed the industry. And Travelocity.com, the first internet travel agency, was launched by our company. And now this guy's been our spokesman here for the last 15 years or so. So we were early players in the industry, and the internet did change everything. So we were smart to be on the front end of that. If you think about how we interact with our customers around the data sets, in any business, we just had a discussion a few minutes ago with a smaller group about the notion that most CEOs would say that their companies should get kind of a C regarding the data that they use, right? Even the small sets of data they have, data about their own customers, data around their own business. So when you start talking about big data, you know, disparate data sets, it's daunting for a lot of companies. And companies talk about it, but they don't really know how to do it. And I think one of my themes that you'll hear me say over and over again in this talk is, this is a big opportunity if you're in, for all of you who are going to be coming out of school, whether it's your first job or your first company. Understanding data and analytics and how powerful it could be to enable your business is an advantage. Not many people have the skill set. So I know you're here to kind of get some practical insight. I suspect you are anyway, to get some practical insight. So I'm going to talk about two specific trends, big data and mobile, how they come together, at least in our business. And I'm going to try to give you some specific examples. Those are built around the context of where I sit in the travel industry and where our company is positioned. And then I have plenty of time for questions. So hopefully you'll think of good questions. If you don't have questions for me, I'll ask you questions. So that'll be the deal. So think about some good questions. So I talked about data. We have big amounts of pricing data, shopping data. I talked about all those transactions. How many of you would think that we're a big data company? Just show of hands. Are we a big data company? Yes? No? Who would say no? Nobody wants to say no. I would say we're somewhere in the middle. You know, I think I'd like to say the answer is yes. I think that data is very much embedded in what we do and our strategy. But it's not because we have lots of data. It's because we've gotten pretty good at gleaning insights for our customers around what the data is telling them to do. But we don't have all the answers. And you know, when we talk about some of the trends today, we understand the trends. We don't always understand the why behind the trend because we haven't figured out how to read the data yet. So we're pretty good at this. So it's kind of a core part of our business. But I think that explains, or at least is an example of when I said not a lot of companies have the expertise. I mean, we do this on behalf of our customers, and we're not all the way there yet, right? So it's a really early field when you start talking about big data. So let's talk about first what big data actually is. There's lots of definitions, but big data is high volume, high velocity, high variety, and it's not just structured data that businesses are used to dealing with, right? It's unstructured data. And so just having a lot of data doesn't make it big data, right? Big data set that's structured, people have known how to deal with that for a long time. Disparate data sets that you're bringing together and then trying to figure them out, especially when some of the data is unstructured, that's what big data is, and that's what technology is moving to be able to facilitate and solve. So we're busy unlocking data, but we're still learning how to apply it broadly. Frankly, we're still trying to learn how to monetize it. Sometimes we do some cool stuff and we don't get paid. And then we're trying to understand the decision making that our customers think is most valuable, right? So we can come up with some great ideas and great insights, but if customers don't know what to do with it and how to action it, it's really not worth much, right? So we're hiring data scientists and other highly skilled folks that need to be working on these issues. But to be clear, you don't have to be a data scientist to play in the field. You don't have to be a data scientist to ask the extra question that says, if we had this, what could we do with it? Or what don't we know about our customer that can really help us do a better job of delivering a service or a product to them or get more revenue from them? What are the things that we need? And I think that awareness of data is going to be really important as well. And that's why, again, I think this program is really valuable because, again, you don't have to be an engineer, you don't have to be a computer scientist, but having an awareness, whether you want to be in fashion marketing or whether you want to be in manufacturing or whether you want to be in the travel industry, having an awareness of the data and the possibilities that come out of analyzing it is really important. It'll make you better. So let's start. I'm going to start with an example that we're using. This is a shopping data example. And about 100,000 hotels or so drive a million shopping queries a day inside of the Sabre system. And I'm going to, didn't want to do that. There we go. All right, I'm going to use this pointer on this one. So these are customer segments, crude ones that we use. So in this weekend getaway segment, what these green spots are shopping requests for a particular property. And down here, these are green is booking. So if you notice that along this line, there's people shopping, nobody's buying, right? Now, being able to visualize this 5 years ago would have been cost prohibitive for us to do it. Because again, it's 100,000 properties. There's all these different markets. There's all these different segments. To be able to do this was really hard. Today, it's relatively cheap and relatively easy. These heat maps, when you look at customer segments, we're able to go into a hotel now and use these heat maps and say, look, if you use our technology and you run campaigns targeted towards these weekend getaway folks in this market, we think they're shopping you. They're just not staying with you. Let's figure out why. So this isn't the answer. This kind of tees up the problem. And then we come behind it with the answer, which is, let's try some marketing campaigns in a variety of different ways to go capture those people that are shopping you but aren't buying you. Now, shopping data in all industries is considered a holy grail. We have a bunch of it. We have a bunch of it. We have it across direct consumer channels with Travelocity. We run the websites for people like JetBlue, who get almost all their business online. And then we have a distribution business that distributes about 60% of the travel in the United States. So we sit on a lot of shopping data. And until recently, storing all of that data and accessing it and then creating visualization around it was really expensive and really hard. So it's just stuff like this wasn't possible. And now it's getting easier. So that's my first example. And I think shopping data in most industries is, again, it's kind of the holy grail because travel is so technical as far as how it's distributed. Access to shopping data is actually pretty easy compared to a lot of other industries. So let me go to another one. This one, I'm going to stick in the hospitality space. This is one of my favorite ones. It's a bit more whimsical. This one would not only have been cost prohibitive, but I think it's nearly impossible just a couple years ago. So this one is sitting in our Sabre Labs group right now. And it's a cool example that we're calling it Hotel Snaps. And it's a prototype that our team came up with. They mined Twitter over a period of 2 weeks for all the photos that were shared on Instagram with either hashtag vacation or hashtag holiday. Okay? And they looked at, they tried to get a feel for the most popular types of photos that people were sharing on their vacations. Then they sent thousands and thousands of photos through the Amazon Mechanical Turk. Does everybody know what that is? Amazon Mechanical Turk, so distributed labor. You know what it is. You can get a big gnome if you do. So yeah, come on down. You can take one of those. Don't take the broken one. The last guy gets the broken one. So tell everybody what the Mechanical Turk is.
Basically, it puts to work a large group of people on the internet who, I guess, they're unemployed.
Well, they're employed once they sign in, right?
When you log in, there are tasks that need like thousands and thousands of small tasks done, but people are willing to do this task. say, like, every 5 seconds you do it. Say, like, there's a picture, and they need tags for this picture. So if it's a guy standing there, you say, guy, business, and then you go to the next photo. And
that's right.
It's basically, like, a lot of small menial tasks done by a ton of people.
Yep. So we took thousands of photos, we pushed them into Mechanical Turk, and we had them do exactly what he said. We had them tag them to say lobby, pool, beach, tourist attraction, mountain, local culture, right? Had them categorized, so we used Mechanical Turk to do that. And then we looked at results and started trying to figure out what can we focus on here to help hotels understand about social media networks where they're trying to attract customers or where they're trying to get opinions. And after mining and comparing the data, we discovered a whole bunch of things. And I can't go into all the things that we discovered, but they're really quirky little insights, right? So we discovered that Marriott properties were the most popular in terms of check-in volume. But Westin had the most check-ins that had a photo attached. That Instagram tends to garner more positive sentiment as a percentage of total than Foursquare regarding a hotel property. And we learned that people that like what's going on are more likely to post a photo, and people that don't like what's going on are more likely to just write a nasty text, right? Keep it in text. Unless it's dirty. Then if something's dirty, they're more likely to take a picture of it and post it. So we learned stuff like that. We're not sure what we're going to do with it, but that's why you build prototypes, right? This early work, though, I would say we're highly confident that we're going to find a way through this type of process to help hotels understand better who's promoting their brand, who's damaging their brand, and what they can do differently to engage with people on social media. So this is I think this is probably the most fun thing that I've seen in the last couple weeks at our company. Okay, now I'm going to go on to Flight Explorer, and there's some people in the room that are really proud of this. So Arnaud, you want to raise your hand? Arnaud is over in Lynnwood, New Jersey. He runs our technology team that builds this product. And sitting with Arnaud is Ralph Hilkins, who's a Villanova MBA, executive MBA alum, who authored a book with Dr. Bill Wagner. He co-authored the first college text on XML technology. But Dr. Wagner said to me, Ralph's a really smart guy. And I said, all of our employees are smart. That's why people want to work here. No, just, we tell all our employees that they're smart. Everybody gets an A at Sabre. No, I'm just kidding. This is aircraft traffic at midday on mid-Atlantic tracks. So those tracks are actually where there are kind of highways in the sky that air traffic control sends planes on. And so they're traffic corridors, and they're usually in places where there's no radar coverage. So it's a way without radar coverage to keep planes spaced properly. The blue dots are aircraft. You can see how they line up on the tracks. And notice how many blue dots there are. Where'd my little clicker go? Pointer. How many blue dots there are in some of this airspace. This will make you afraid to travel when you see how cluttered. Look at over here. We're tracking about 29 million aircraft a year. So this US airspace is quite crowded. It's particularly crowded in the Northeast. And Flight Explorer monitors it. This is what sits inside most system operations control centers at airlines. It's actually much more advanced technology than air traffic control uses. Unfortunately, air traffic control is using very old technology. But the airlines have pretty good technology, trying to help them figure out how to effectively route, how to save the most fuel, how to swap positions across aircraft. And these, I'm going to call on Arnaud maybe later in the Q&A and ask him to give a better definition, because these guys live this stuff all day long. But this is built on top of a whole bunch of data. Disparate data sets, everything from weather to performance information on the aircraft to whole bunch of real-time situational analysis of what's going on in airspace. So this is a real-time big data application, and it's highly visual. And again, most airlines around the world are using this inside their system operations control. This is another view, just to give you a sense of how what else airlines look at. On this one, You're looking at specific airspace. It's over Miami International Airport. It's during a thunderstorm. And so these pink lines, The pink lines are airplanes that are circling. And again, the application has to be very aware of everything that's going on, because storms move, right? It is real, you know, storms are a real-time issue. Wind is a real-time issue. Other aircraft entering the space are real-time issues. So being able to understand what's going on in the space in an irregular operation is one of the higher value applications of Flight Explorer. So that's the kind of stuff that our teams are doing around using data on the aircraft side. This one isn't quite as visual, but we have an application called Intel Exchange, and it actually is one of the more innovative technologies that we've come up at Sabre in a long time. It was built by a team in Reykjavik, Iceland. They have a lot of time on their hands, especially in the winter. They built some really cool stuff here. This is going to be a major disruptor in the airline space. Airlines have data in silos all over their enterprise. Again, a lot of companies do, right? And in many cases, it hasn't been updated in a long time. They have a hard time extracting that data and doing anything at all with it. Intel Exchange is actually an infrastructure software, but it's an infrastructure play that's able to extract data from across the enterprise and bring it together and make it usable. So a couple examples of what we're doing with Intel Exchange. One example is we're taking data from loyalty system, from real-time operations, and from seat inventory, and we're creating models that allow an airline to say, all right, I have a traveler who just lost their bag. I'm able to quickly see that person's one of my most loyal travelers, high value score, and then check seat inventory on that person's next event to do something nice for him or her, right? Upgrade them, give them free bags, whatever it might be, but to respond to the fact that they had a service failure. Airlines would like to do that. Sounds logical and easy. It's really hard for airlines to be responsive in the environment that they're, you know, it's a big logistical problem every day moving all these people around. So having data that can be responsive real time, and again, do all of that without any human intervention and actually just make it happen, is what Intel Exchange will allow. The other thing, and this is a technology that you can build lots of different applications on top of. Another application that we built on top of it is called, it's a revenue integrity application that looks for fraudulent bookings, looks for duplicates, and it goes in and scrubs the bookings to release seats, right? Because seats, once the airplane takes off, the seat's gone, right? So if you have duplicates on the plane, you've missed an opportunity to sell. We're seeing 300% improvements in seats released back into inventory when people are using the application on top of Intel Exchange. So big revenue impact for customers, a great use of allowing them to get at data and then figure out a way to use it. Okay, so now I'm going to move to mobile a little bit. I said earlier, at the dawn of the internet, we talked about internet enable everything. It's the perfect metaphor for mobile enable everything, right? It's the same story. Businesses are having to move everything to mobile. The challenge here, though, there's a bunch of them. I'll talk about a few, but one of the challenges is when we were going down the path of the internet, it was clear that you can get cost advantage by using the internet. You can get customer interaction advantage. You can go global quicker. There's a whole bunch of things that came with being on the internet that were really early and quick business benefits. The deal with mobile, though, is that you don't get to stop doing anything, right? It's new. It's a new investment. And you're not really sure if you're ever going to make more money because of it or get an extra customer, but you do know that if you don't do it, you're going to be in trouble. So again, the internet, the big application in travel initially was, gosh, if we could just service people on the internet and get out of these expensive call centers, that's a no-brainer, right? This is like, oh God, we got to build a mobile app. And oh, by the way, I got to build it for iPhone and Android and maybe BlackBerry, if old people use it. There's like a bunch of things that you got to think about. And it's just initially kind of added cost, right? But you have to be there. The other thing is that you've lost control of the work, right? work that's being done by your own people, work that's being done by your software, is now being done by your customer. And that's scary, right? Because, you know, how do I control that? How do I not lose control of the value I provide if all of a sudden the customer's doing stuff for themselves as they travel, right? In our industry, especially. So it's a big trend. It's another change everything trend. But let me start out with devices, because how many marketing students are there in here? All right, so how do marketers traditionally look at customers? What's the kind of the standard textbook model these days? How do they think about segmenting them, or what kind of stuff, what kind of data do they look at? Any views? Attitudinal. Demographic, huge. Past purchases, right, that's one. So how about this? People who have Macs have different purchasing patterns than people who have Wintel PCs. People who have iPads purchase differently when they're using their iPad than they do when they're on their Mac. And people that have smartphones actually purchase the same as people that have iPhones, right? We started talking about that, and marketers looked at us like we had three heads, right? They're like, no, that can't be, right? Where does he live? How much income does she have? What did she buy last week? That's what's important, right? It's not true. The data says it's not true. Data says that if you buy a hotel on your iPad, that you consume it within 7 days, and if you buy it on your PC, you consume it within about 20 days. Right? That's a pretty big deal. Right? People are acting differently depending on what device they're using. That's a whole new way to segment. And you know, it's very counterintuitive for most marketers, but the data says it's true. So understanding devices is important. I'm going to talk about an example out of lastminute.com. So most of you probably don't know lastminute.com. Lastminute.com is our brand in Europe. And it's known as one of the most irreverent brands in the UK. It's a great UK brand. It's so our most famous ad for lastminute.com was a couple years ago. We ran a campaign all over London. I mean, heavy all over London, mostly print. And the billboard said, "Surprise your girlfriend for Valentine's Day. Take her sister to Barcelona." It's the kind of brand, it's a cheeky brand. It's a little irreverent, right? That was one of the cleaner campaigns. We had some dicey campaigns. We'd never showed those campaigns to our board. So here's the example. So let's say you're with your friends and you're at the very chic number 5 Maddox Street Hotel in London, probably the coolest hotel. Our dean probably stays there. I bet he does. Did he leave already? Yeah. Pat probably stays there because it's the chicest hotel in all of London. So you're at number five Maddox Street, and it's about 6 p.m. and you're having your first cocktail, and you decide that you want to book a room for that night in London. You live outside of London. You don't want to take the train or drive home. You're going to book a room, and of course, because we're smart. We have your mobile app is location aware. So guess what? We know you're at number 5 Maddox Street, right? And you do a shopping request for a hotel. Anybody want to guess what the first couple results would be? Who wants to guess?
That hotel.
Number 5 Maddox Street. It's a great answer. Anybody else? Guesses? There's lots of hotels in London, right? Maybe the one next door, the little less chic hotel. That's next door to number 5 Maddox Street. Okay. Look, we for a long time, when we first launched the app, guess what? You got a great deal on number 5 Maddox Street. Probably 40% off, which is probably £275 instead of, you know, 500, 600 pounds. And that's what we did for a while. And guess what? Guess what we learned? Who wants to guess? Anybody have a guess what we learned? All right, armed with data, we learned that the best thing we know about a person in London, in the city of London, when they shop for a hotel after 5 o'clock, the number one most likely thing to happen is that they will not spend more than 100 pounds. Number one, like 85% of the time, right? So we ran a test, we capped the price ranges, we narrowed the search display. After 4 o'clock in London, we started returning only hotels that had a price range under 120 pounds. And we saw bookings between 7 p.m. and 11 p.m. increase 400% in 1 week. 1 week. So again, counterintuitive. We knew where the person was. Of course they want to stay. I'm sure, and actually, we're sure that they probably wanted to stay at number 5 Maddox Street, right? They just didn't want to pay for it, right? After 5 o'clock, it's an impulse purchase. They weren't looking for that kind of experience. And that we only would know that through data. Understanding how people interact with technology, in this case their mobile device, catering to it, can result in big revenue. And if you don't get it right, you really can get yourself in trouble. Now, mobile success and monetization is a whole different issue, and I'm going to talk about that here. We've made a big bet on a product called TripCase, and its primary focus, it's a mobile app that helps frequent travelers manage every aspect of their trip experience, and it's free, right? So whether it's your flight, your hotel, your black car, your restaurant reservation, you put it all in one place, and you can kind of flip through your trip on your phone, and we also send you real-time alerts, so flight delays, weather, all kinds of information, maps. It's one of the top travel management apps on the iStore. We have 4.5 stars. It's the first mobile app that has partnered with American Express and i4Travel, which is somebody that an organization that works in our industry identified it and awarded it with the best mobile application of 2013 in travel space. Why are we doing this and why is it free? It's what I said earlier. We work that happens that travelers are starting to do for themselves, travel agencies traditionally did, and they traditionally did it with our desktop capability, right? Ceding this space sounds like a bad idea, right? Ceding that work to somebody else sounds like a bad idea. We still haven't figured out how to monetize, but we're pretty sure of a couple things. One, let's talk about the demographics. So 44% of the world's population looks a lot like the folks, most of you in this room, right? Under 24, technically savvy, uses a mobile phone, which is increasingly a smartphone, and travels a lot more frequently than previous generations, right? And your expectations for service and your expectations for how to deal with things when they go wrong and how to do them quickly is different than other demographic segments. So we're pretty sure that we're not going to make a mistake by being in mobile, right? But we have to be really smart about it, right? So I think what we are sure of is if we don't figure out the data on the behaviors of what's going on and how people use this app, we will never, ever make money. Because that's where all the money's going to be, is understanding and providing insights to our customers, to the hotels that sit inside the app, to the airlines that sit inside the app, and to continue to make it better. We're going to have to understand data about how customers are interacting with it, why they're interacting that way, what they're doing, how they're doing it, and if we don't get smart about the data, then we're in trouble. So what does that mean? I actually think, and I talk to folks about mobile quite a bit, that if you're building mobile apps and you're not building the infrastructure underneath it to capture data and understand it, you will fail. Over time, you'll fail. You just won't make money. It's really hard. It's a really hard place to make money. So you could build the coolest app in the world, but if you don't build the infrastructure underneath it to capture and understand data, you're never going to make money at it. At least it's going to be pretty hard. So I talked about a lot of current examples. I have to go back and mention one thing. So we Information Week has a list that they put out not too long ago. It's called Greatest Software Ever Written. And we were number 7 on that list. Sabre System was number 7 on the list of greatest software ever written. I'm hoping that one of these things replaces the original Sabre System as greatest software ever written. Maybe it'll be TripCase. We'll see. Maybe it'll be Flight Explorer. Let me wrap up. So assuming that you're here because you're interested in data science, travel technology, maybe you're taking some of these business analytics courses, and you're curious about career opportunities in the field, I know that data is going to continue to explode. That's just a trend, right? So the doubling the data set size every year is real. Total cumulative data is almost unmanageable at most enterprises. So being smart about this stuff, again, I can't say it enough, it will make you a better business owner. It'll make you a better business person if you're understanding these disciplines. It's hard stuff, but it's where the action is. And I always like to encourage people to kind of dive head first into the hot spots. This is a hot spot. So if you're thinking about a career, whether it's in the arts, whether it's in sciences, whether it's in the healthcare field, whether it's in travel, this is really relevant stuff, right? Understanding data and how it can be used. I have no doubt that someone in this room, or maybe even several of you, since it's Villanova, are going to be rock stars in the space. That you'll change companies, you'll change industries, you'll change the world with understanding how to use data and get insights into things that you could never do before. And I'd like to point out that, you know, it's so important at an enterprise like ours that as we talk about the core strategy of the whole company, we talk about big data. Obviously, I talked about, you know, when you're in business, this silly thing of having to actually figure out a way to charge people and make money always gets in the way of innovation. But it's pretty important. We have to figure out how to monetize. But it's on our radar screen as one of the things that we just have to do as a company. The breakthroughs in this, as far as where data will come from next, are huge. Boeing and Airbus are starting to put sensors on aircraft that tell what's going on with the aircraft real time. So if you think about Flight Explorer and how can that become relevant, how can airlines know that a part's going to fail before it's going to fail, right? But because of these sensors that are on data, those are the types of things that are going on that are disrupting whole industries and changing whole industries. So in closing up, I hope many of you will pursue careers in this area. I hope one or two of you or three of you decide to do it in Texas or over in Linwood and join us at Sabre. We're always looking for great talent. I know there's great talent up here. We do a lot of recruiting at Texas schools and kind of the middle of the country, not as much up here, but Villanovans are welcome. I just learned about you being a, I didn't realize you had a Villanova deal. So there's now five people that I know of at Villanova, which is starting to screw up the, I was for a while, we had me and one of our vice presidents were at Villanova. So I used to walk around saying, Villanova grads are the most successful people at Sabre, because on average, we're like an executive VP, right? So now we have five. We have a lawyer who went to law school here, who's a director, and we have kind of the smartest guy in the room over here who wrote a textbook on XML with a professor, and we have a developer who got his MBA here as well. So I keep teasing him that he has to get promoted to kind of get the average up. So hopefully one of you will be successful at our company too. I do think this is a trend that changes everything, both mobile and big data. In closing up, I said earlier that I'm very proud to be here. I just think you're so lucky to have Father Peter as president of this university and Dean Medjidi as the head of the business school. I was good friends with Jim Danko. I like the transition to Dean Medjidi. He's brought great energy here to the business school. So you're lucky to have that kind of leadership here. I'm really proud of the school. And again, I really thank you for choosing to be part of the Villanova family. Thanks.